So thank you so much to the organizing committee for inviting me. It is a pleasure to talk about something very dear to my heart and what I see just about every day in my practice at the One Dream National Medical Center in Bethesda. And I've seen some friendly faces of people that have worked with me in the past. I get reminded that we did a lot of research back when the hepatitis viruses were not so well known. But now, of course, things have changed. Although, as I'm going to show you in some of the slides, we still have a challenge. Not so much on diagnosing and treating hepatitis C, like the access to care and who should be providing it. So I need to show you my disclosures, and then I also need to tell you that upon completion of this talk, you should be able to understand the epidemiological trends of hepatitis C infection, the gaps that exist in the hepatitis C care continuum, to discuss the potential role of primary care in providing hepatitis C care, and discuss the evidence for task shifting in hepatitis C care. And of course, it goes without saying that if at any point things are not understandable, just let me know and I'll try to answer your questions. So, talking about the epidemiological aspects of hepatitis C. You can see here that there are several million people in the U.S. that have hepatitis C. And some of them have antibodies shown in the bars in green, and some of them have not only the antibody but also the RNA. The RNA is a marker of active infection. The antibody may be there just from past infection, but the RNA is what is important. Now, in the NHANES study, which is the little graphs, showed us that we had about 2.7 million people actively infected in the country, and that was in 2010. But there have been added some populations that were not counted in the NHANES study, because as you remember, the NHANES is a study of several cities of people that are actively working, that live in homes, and did not consider populations that are incarcerated, populations that are homeless or hospitalized, or even in reservations or military populations that could be transient. So when we add those to the 2.7 that they came up, we come up with 3.5 million at the present time that are actively infected with hepatitis C in the country. So that's the number we go by. And just in passing, I will tell you that the rate of hepatitis C is higher than HIV in the U.S. So it is like three times higher. So when studies have been done to see if people are aware that they have hepatitis C, it's the minority indeed that they are. And so there is a whole lot of outreach to try to get people to be tested for hepatitis C. So overall, as you can see there, 59% were aware of the hepatitis C status, and then there were groups, particularly in ethnic populations and poverty level population that were not aware at all of the fact that they had hepatitis C. So important to know, depending on the population that you work with, that they may or may not know, and so there is a push for screening more and more. Now you can see that only 6% of the patients were prescribed therapy. And this we're talking about, you know, with people that have insurance, because all of them that are against single or caring for or the Kaiser Permanente are covered by insurance. And so it wasn't that they couldn't afford it. It is the challenge to get therapy is still very much there, even in populations that are so lucky to be taken care of. So here is some identifications of why the problem. So you can see here that, as I said before, not everybody that has antibody has active disease, but if you have the RNA test positive, then obviously you are actively infected and that needs to be corrected. And if we go on down the road of this this slide, you can see that about 81% received test results and about 76% were referred to primary care or specialty care. But look at only 44% kept the medical appointment. So we are starting to identify some of the challenges in diagnosing and treating hepatitis C. Is not just that the providers are not doing the job, but we are not reaching the patients. And so they, although they have an appointment to go see a specialist or primary care, they are not doing it. And we need to explore the reasons why. This is a simulated model that was published last year in Hepatology, actually 2015. And this is an evaluated model called HEP simulation, in which they started this analysis from 2001 and they're continuing on. And basically what they do is based on the statistics, the current statistics, they project and they see, okay, what's gonna happen in the next 10 years. So you can see here that in 2010, there were 2.4 million infected, actively infected. 2015, it decreases to 2 million, and by 2020, it's going to be less than 1 million. But it's taking 10 years to get there, to get to reach patients and cure them. So, in the next slides, I'm going to show you on this simulation study that people that we're going to take 10 years or longer to treat them, then we're going to be diminishing cirrhosis or cancer of the liver or liver related mortality in a less amount than if we were able to increase the simulated number of 280,000 cured to 400,000. So in green is the actual rate of what we see that is going to be happening, and in blue is what we can accomplish if we were able to get more patients treated in the same 10 years. So this is an important look at the future for us to keep in mind. So what are the barriers to hepatitis C treatment? So there is not just one thing, it's several of them. So one of the most important ones is hepatitis C gives you no symptoms. Overall, liver disease gives you very few symptoms. And I tell my patients, if we wait until the symptoms appear, the ballgame is over. Because if you're going to come to clinic jaundice, you're going to come with ascites, with edema. Bleeding is very limited things that we can do for you. Or you're going to come with cancer of the liver. Then, you know, we have to be proactive because, you know, I've seen it in clinic. Patients are going well, And then one day, the liver gives up. And the next day, they are deadly. It's just, you know, like a 24-hour thing. Say, but yesterday I was running around, I was doing my thing, and now I'm all swell up. That's how liver behaves. It's not an easy thing. So, also, you know, people, there had been a stigma, I guess there is still a stigma of having hepatitis C. As a matter of fact, I teach my fellows, my residents, not to ask for the risk factors anymore. What does it matter? If I'm going to treat them, whether they got a blood transfusion, whether they were sexually promiscuous, whether they did any drugs, it doesn't matter at this point. They have a hepatitis C, they need to be treated. That's the bottom line. So, you know, hopefully we're making inroads on that because it is still a barrier. And of course, you know, if patients don't have insurance, if the physicians are not aware and do not screen patients, then that is a problem. Other barriers that exist is that there's a limited number of specialists, and there is a failure to identify sometimes the need for refer, you know, because patients that have advanced disease need to be referred, that people that have compensated disease can be treated by the primary care provider. Now, the referral to specialist also has intrinsic barriers, such as sometimes insurance kicks back, and they don't want the patient to be referred for all these reasons, you know, they have to pay for it. So it's not, it's a concern. Even some of my patients that are totally covered, 100% covered by the military, by the Department of Defense health insurance, they ask me, they say, how much is this going to cost? I don't have money to pay for this, and I have to remind them that they are not going to pay any, no copay, nothing. It is just, you know, the government, we're blessed, the government will pay for it. So even in that population that is covered, there are concerns about it. Then, you know, sometimes we make it difficult for patients because they live long ways away. So it's hard to come to clinic, hard to come for checkups or monitoring, so it could be a problem. And sometimes communication, you know, we do have a sizable population of people that don't speak English, their parents or their spouses, and we need to rely on translators, you know, and so on. We wonder how much are we reaching these patients to make sure they understand they cannot miss one pill. So you can see, before even initiating treatment, that there are a whole lot of problems. Want to remind you also, what are the goals of therapy according to our associations, the American Association for Liver Diseases, the Infectious Disease Society. We want to reduce all-cause mortality and liver-related health adverse consequences, including end-stage liver disease and hepatocellular carcinoma, by achieving a cure. And I also want to emphasize that because hepatitis C is just about the only viral chronic disease that is cured. Hepatitis B is not cured, it's gotten under remission. HIV, under remission, herpes under remission, and so forth and so on. And hepatitis C, once that virus is dead for good. You have to get reinfected to get another bout of hepatitis C. So all patients, our association say that all patients with hepatitis C should be treated. And that has not always been the case. As well as the United States. I'm showing this slide to show you what I mean. Except in patients that the life expectancy is so short that it should be referred, it should be consulted if you expect somebody to live a year or less, then you know, and they've lived all their lives with their hepatitis C. What's the point of spending time and money? Here is what I meant when I say that there were barriers depending on the degree of hepatitis C. You see here on the left, 74% and limited the criteria for treatment to people with advanced fibrosis. You know, so the minority of, you know, it's just, I've always had an animosity to that concept, because hepatitis C to me is progressive. And so if you have a little fibrosis now, you will have a whole lot more fibrosis later. So what am I waiting for? But Medicaid and some of the insurances follow that, including the VA in early years. They have removed those limitations, but they expected the patients to have cirrhosis to treat it. And as I expressed to you before, patients that have cirrhosis are at risk of worse things. So to me, that was wrong thinking. Also, some of the barriers that sometimes are imposed on us is that we require a period of abstinence or urine drug screening in those patients. And there have been studies after studies that show that people that are actively using or their methadone programs, they can be treated. That it is indeed a good motivation to be taken seriously, to give a treatment. Obviously, the patient is drunk, you know, out of his or her skull, then that's a different story. But we've got to be cognizant that sometimes we as providers or a society may put roadblocks on the treatment of these patients. So how do we expand the hepatitis C care continuum? How do we deal with these problems? And so there are some roles that we play. You know, like men play some roles, women play some roles. Also in hepatitis C, there are roles. Internist and primary care clinics traditionally have been the screening venues. And then they refer to hepatology, gastroenterology, or ID for treatment. And so this generates a significant delay or failure. You know, when you are passing the baton or the ball to another player, the ball may be dropped. And so there are patient factors. There are provider factors. You know, there are some patients that refuse to be seen by anybody but their provider. You know, and I have some of them, my colleagues have some of them, and it doesn't matter. You know, I get calls for patients because they have a urinary problem or a heart problem or a lung problem, and they have been advised to do a B or C, but they won't do it unless I tell them to. You know, it's just amazing to me how we behave. But that's the way, maybe because, you know, we've learned to trust a person that is going to tell us things straight, and then others are new to the game and we don't know what's going on. So, you know, those are just facts of nature that we all have, I guess, to some extent. Also, the specialists, there are long waiting times to get to see a specialist. So that's another factor. So we think that internists and primary care settings are going to be the key factors to expand the continuum of hepatitis C treatment. So here's a couple of examples on such a thing. The ECHO model. It's a very, very fabulous model that some physicians in Arizona started some years ago. And this is a telehealth medicine. So they are in a conference room like this with computers, and then they are providing advice to people. First it was in Arizona, and then they branch out to several places in the country. in which the physicians could discuss their cases and get advice on how to treat the patients. So you see now, in this particular observation study, there were multiple ecocides in Arizona, New Mexico, Oklahoma, Texas, Utah, and Washington State. And they observed that whether the treatment was at the academic center or whether the treatment was at the distant learning center, it was a 0.7% difference in achieving cure. So they, I'll show you some statistics on that. You know, they kind of make sure that the treatment was stable, was, you know, the top of the line. I don't know if we can say the Cadillac anymore, because I think that there are cars and Cadillacs these days. But you can see here the echo program in green and the specialty clinics in blue. And at a glance, you can see that there is no much difference, at least not a statistically significant difference. So regardless of whether the treatment was 4 weeks, 12 weeks, or some special drugs that we had to use, the treatment was absolutely spectacular in achieving sustained viral response. So this is one example, and then this is another one. The VA echo, the VA has adopted this system in some of their regions, and so they have even a more comprehensive program. You can see there in the table in blue, they have a curriculum of training. So they don't just turn you loose to do it. You have to complete a curriculum of training in order to be a telehealth provider, which I think is fabulous. And moreover, they also have teleconferences every 1 to 2 weeks where you can present your most challenging cases. And that I think is terrific, because we all have one of the cases that, you know, we are stumped. And so they have a pretty good system nowadays. And so here is some more statistics of patients in this VA echo. And you can see the primary care provider exposed patients refer for individualized care 9%. So they were able to treat the bulk of the patients. Now, these patients that the VA echo treats are mainly rural, less likely to go to a medical center because they are far away. They are less likely to have hepatitis C genotype missing, which of course the genotype is going to tell you what treatment to use. They had similar incidence of depression, schizophrenia, bipolar, substance abuse disorders, whether they were treated by primary care or by non-primary care. And here in this slide, I show you the green line shows you the patients that were exposed to the primary care. They got a very quick step to treatment, as opposed to the patients that were treated by somebody else. So on the blue lines. So you can see, you know, the bottom line was the treatment was the same 12 weeks or 24 weeks. The SVR were the same, but these patients got treatment quick. There was no delay. So obviously, because there is access to care, these people knew what they were doing. If they had questions, they asked them, they got it resolved, and they went to treat the patient without delay. So I think, you know, that is an important step in the therapy of some of our patients. Here's another look. This is the Ascend study that was published last year. This is with nurse practitioners, primary care physicians, or specialists. And then the treatment is standardized, so we don't have any changes due to that. And the patients are very similar in the ones that were treated by nurse practitioners or primary care or specialists. And what did they see? At a glance, you can see also all patients in green, very good, because these drugs are so fabulous. You know, 90%, 95% response rates. But you can see the nurse practitioners that did splendidly well. The primary care did very well, and the specialists did very well too. So it kind of underscores what I have been saying. It's not the type of provider, it's that the provider needs to be knowledgeable, and the patients need to have access to that provider to be treated. So I think, you know, I'm painting a theme to you that if we want to expand the care of hepatitis C, we have to have our colleagues in primary care and nurse practitioners help us with that. So what would be the challenges and next steps? So this is a survey that was done anonymously at an Arbor VA hospital. And they included primary care providers in different specialties, geriatrics, family medicine, pediatrics, and about 80 completed the survey. And they were young, 36 to 50, so, you know, close to medical school, knowledgeable. And I'll show you what their perspectives were. So they asked these people what were the primary problems to screen for hepatitis C. Some, and the main one was time constraints, because, you know, 10, 15 minute appointment, very hard to accomplish everything needs to be done. Still, with that, and they were sure if they had been screened before or not. They felt that if they had an electronic medical record, then that would be a much better thing, because then they can see clearly, you know, we do have an electronic medical record. I think most of us do. And it's just so easy to go into the lab and see if the test was done or not. So the barriers to screening, also insurance coverage. Sometimes, you know, insurance won't allow that, and they demand to know what the risk factors are. In general terms, also if the primary care thought the patient was not eligible for treatment, then they did screen. So here is the, again, more of the perspectives. These patients were referred at 100% if they had advanced disease. And I think that's proper, because, you know, people with advanced liver disease need a lot of care for their endoscopy and any present disease. So that's very appropriate. But they also refer if therapy was indicated, which tells you immediately that they didn't feel comfortable with treating patients. And 70% of them said that they were not up to date with current treatment. And I will tell you, the treatment is diffuse, it's a lot. There's a lot of treatments out there. But if you learn it, or you have, you know, something in your on the wall that guides you, or if you stick to one or two type of treatments, you can learn it very well. It's not that difficult. But they felt that they were not well equipped. So you see here in the light blue is the people, the primary care, that felt themselves experts or knowledgeable. And in the green and the dark blue are people that felt their skills were limited. And you can see the ability to treat hepatitis C or the ability to know the current guidelines, the majority, 77%, 76% said that they did not find themselves well educated. So something for us to pay attention, because obviously we need to go on to primary care and teach them and guide them or work with them, you know, in a sponsorship, so they can feel confident about it. So they felt that only 22% of them felt that the treatment should be provided by the primary care. They just did not feel confident. This is a very important message that they gave us. And so, you know, I think, you know, additional training, 91% were interested in additional training, and that is also very telling of where we are now in terms of treating hepatitis C. So in my last slides, I just want to summarize that time, limited knowledge, changing guidelines, and insurance-based restrictions play a major role in expanding the care of treatment of hepatitis C. It is definitive barriers for us that we need to work with. Primary care is a huge resource for us. And then also that we cannot just stay in our clinics, but I think we need to expand and go to community health centers, to tertiary care clinics, to drug and alcohol clinics, to prisons, to identify and treat patients. So we cannot just wait for patients to come to us, but we gotta do outreach and go to where the patients are. So in summary then, I hope I have explained to you there are significant barriers to the hepatitis C care continuum that thus shifting to primary care providers has been demonstrated in several instances to be excellent and be a good way to expand provision of treatment. There are still many challenges to treatment remain, and that we expect that with coordinated care, we can get this challenge out of the way in the future years. So thank you for your questions. Yeah.
As a primary care physician, the screens for hepatitis C, I send the patients to a gastroenterologist for more than one reason. One is that the medication that's generally used now is very expensive and requires a lot of intervention to get it approved by the insurance company. And I don't think there's any primary care doctor has that kind of time. So what words to use to try to get approved?
Right, yes, and that is, I mean, the time constraints are very much a factor, and you're right that sometimes you have to go back, the insurances will refuse, and then you have to send another letter to get those patients treated. The pharmaceutical companies have become very savvy about it, so they have drafts of letters that they provide to physicians so they can, you know, cut and paste for their patients. Or they become very careful because, of course, they're interested in selling the drug. But I hear what you're saying, and I think, you know, part of the problem is the price. And so it is a challenge still for us. And there is competition for the different medications, so hopefully the price is more competitive now, especially for Medicare, Medicaid, and government places. But still, there is a number of people out there that I can imagine that it is clinic. But maybe the thing to do is to test it, and if they are positive, then send them over to gastroenterology, because, you know, I've seen patients down on the outside with serious liver disease, in which they went to see one of my colleagues, and they did an endoscopy, they did a colonoscopy, and they didn't address the liver at all. And I am shocked, and I know some of them, I am shocked. I say, what did they say about your liver disease? Nothing. And they did an endoscopy, they did a colonoscopy, and then they said, well, everything is normal, so I don't know what you got. And these are full-fledged gastroenterologists, so some of our colleagues are just looking at one end. So I wouldn't take it for granted that they are risk-free.
Any further questions?
Quickly, would you comment on viral resistance to the regimens?
Yes, yes. So viral resistance is a very important topic. And one of the reasons why we instruct patients to don't miss one pill, because that's all that the virus is waiting for. For patients to, you know, go on vacation,
yeah,
and they forget the pills, and then the virus becomes resistant. But there are several studies that show that some of the medications, like the ones that were used in some of the studies here, the sofosbuvir, the lipazvir, just go through resistance and take care of it. You know, the majority. Some of them are sturdy and they would come back up. And in August, there is a new medication that will be looked at by the FDA, especially for people that have become resistant to previous medications, because we realize that it's a problem. Now, it's a minor problem, thank God, because 95%, 99% get cured. So, but still, that percentage is of course of importance to deal with.
We want to thank Dr. Sjogren, just in